AKA Mother.
Greetings, the Astro 30 here yet again with another little kit build to do. Now, I don't want to turn this into the amplifier channel, but amplifiers is kind of what I'm good at. Anyway, this project is called the Bionic Ear, and it's from Short Circuits Volume 2, Project 15, and its catalogue number is KJ8226, and it's $21.95 without instructions. The instructions are in the book, available online as a PDF file for the whole entire book, which is cheaper and free, or you can buy the separate instructions for this in store for $2.50. I've also got a 9-volt battery that was about $5. Is there a catalog number on this? No, there's not. So we won't worry about that. Expiry date on bottom of battery. Ooh. Indeed there is. It's the 9th month of 2027. They really expect this battery to last 5 years? Okay. It's just the standard JCar brand Eclipse batteries, the cheapest alternative batteries. I mean, you can go to Reject Shop and buy Polaroid 9-volt batteries for about $2.50, but they don't last very long. Do not use them in smoke alarms. Buy a decent battery for a smoke alarm, such as an Energizer or Duracell, not these cheap brands, and especially not the Polaroid batteries. You will be sorely disappointed. Anyway, we're going to open this in a minute, but first we're going to look at the printout of the instructions that I've got. And here is a look at the schematic. Yes, this uses a mini electret microphone, so that requires a small forward voltage, DC voltage, on the element to make it work, which is what this 10K resistor here is for. Which any DC coming off the microphone is now blocked by this 100 nanofarad capacitor, which goes into IC1A, which is part of an LM833. And its gain, it's a non-inverting, and its gain is set to around 470 with these two resistors. That then goes through another 100 nanofarad capacitor at its output into a logarithmic 10K pot, which is our volume or gain control, which is then again going through a 220 nanofarad into the second part of the LM833, which is forming our output stage, for want of a better word. And we see these 247K resistors here, which are forming a voltage divider at the pin 5, which is the positive input. Now this gives us a bias voltage to this op amp so it can work correctly on a single supply, because it is only running off a 9-volt battery. The gain of this is actually an inverting amplifier. The gain of this is set by this resistor, the 22K and the 68K, and that gives us roughly a gain of 3. The output is then fed into these two transistors, which I'm assuming are going to be operating in class A, because there should be a DC voltage here as well, because it's running single-ended supply. That remains to be seen. That's why there's a capacitor here on the output before the headphone socket, so no DC gets through, but only the AC does. That's fair enough. And this transistor here is what's known as an amplified diode, but for all intents and purposes, you might as well call it a VBE multiplier. It just provides the correct quiescent current to these two output transistors, which is then set with this little trim pot here. Now, these two transistors, which are a PN100 and PN200, they don't provide any voltage gain to the amplifier. They just provide current, enough current in order to drive the headphones directly, or go into a tape recorder or whatever you want to plug it into. But that's basically, in a nutshell, how the circuit works. It's not that complicated, and it is basically, for me, what I've seen before. Now, they do go on to say how you can further make this into a spy device, if you want to call it that, for eavesdropping. This is a salad or fruit bowl, the wooden type that you used to be able to get several years ago. I haven't seen any for sale in Woolworths or Coles or even Kmart, so I don't know if you can even still get these ones, but a plastic bowl would still work the same. This works on the same principle as a satellite dish, where all the radio waves were focused on the satellite dish and then beamed back up into the detector. In this case, it's picking up all the sound waves, pressure waves, and bouncing them back to the microphone to make it very directional. So this is what you can do in the what to do next part of the instructions. And they give you a suggestion of how to put it into a zippy box and such. And basically this reflector dish is what's known as a parabolia, or uses the parabolic formula to calculate how the waves bounce back again. That's just what it's called. Anyhow, let's have a look at the contents of the kit. Now, I didn't really need the printout of the schematic. It was only just for video purposes. However, when the board was in prototype stage, the overlay diagram may have been helpful, but it does actually give you the wiring, external wiring in those instructions. This is an irrelevant piece of information, just says what it is for the short circuit series. There is our circuit board. Very, very nice, J-Car. Up to your usual standards. So you don't really need the instructions to build the thing because all the component values are marked on the silkscreen print of the circuit board. But yes, it's certainly a neat manufactured board. So I'll put that to the side for a minute. These are a bag of our components. Let's try that again in angle. What the f***? These are our bag of components. See, we've got the resistors here, the variable resistor, the trim pot, that is, and some PCB pins which you put in. We've got the IC down here. It doesn't look like they provided an IC socket, so if you're not confident in soldering directly to integrated circuits, buy an IC socket. It cost you about probably 50 cents, I think it is, for the cheap non-machined one. It may even be less, I don't remember offhand. They give us the control knob, a bit of shielded wire for the microphone, and a little bit of speaker wire there for the output connector, capacitors, and of course the volume pot itself. So it's a fairly straightforward kit, and they've also provided a 9-volt battery clip, which is handy, otherwise you won't get power to it. But it's a very straightforward kit. It's not that complicated to put together. They're using green cap capacitors, which is old style 600 volt. I think they're 600 volt, which I haven't seen since like the late 90s, but people still use them, I suppose. And there's one lonely little electric lytic capacitor over here, which is the 10 microfarad. Not sure why that's off by itself. Maybe it got into a fight with the other capacitors, and so it was subjected to being ousted over there. I don't know. Anyway, I'm going to stop talking crap about this now, and let's start actually assembling it. Alright, now I've got you off to the side, because it's easier, because the tripod's in the way otherwise. Now, I would start with the lower profile components first, such as resistors. And I'm using the box the kit came in as a component tray. And if you're as lazy like I am and can't be bothered reading the color codes on these resistors, just use a multimeter and measure it. And it says it's 21.9, so it's 22k. I might see if I can speed that up because it is a little slow. That's better, 22k. So we'll find where a 22k goes, and we fit the resistor in the required hole. Now, I'm not going to film everything on the process of assembly. I'm going to do some assembly, and then I'm going to come back. The 22k goes there, and I'm going to put them the right way around so the electrons don't fall out. That joke is wearing a little thin. So just do that, measure the resistors, stick it in, solder it. Simple. Now, they do supply a handy little roll of solder here, so I'm going to use it. And yes, I know I need to get a pencil tip, or conical as I call it. That's later on the cards. And a short time later, about 10 minutes, all the resistors are soldered in. Now, that one's a bit high. I can fix that in a minute. For the average person that has basic electronics knowledge, you should be able to assemble this kit in no longer than 45 minutes. It's going well so far, but I'm going to fix that resistor up and then we'll move on to the next bit. The next thing I would consider installing is this 1N4004 diode. This is used in series with the battery connections just as a reverse voltage protection diode, basically. So whilst all the components are still flat on the board and there's no large components sticking up, we can prop this in. Now this diode's not going to draw much current, so you can leave it flat to the board like that, it's fine. I don't see any issues with it. This circuit would be lucky to draw 100 mA. So that's that soldered in. I'll just trim off our leads. Okay, there we go. Now the next thing I would suggest installing is this variable resistor, which is a 10K. I believe, yeah, it says 10K on it. Because it is fairly low profile, but there are other holes here for different types of pot. So you can even install a smaller one. It's in footprint size, but it sticks up a bit more. I think you can put a 10-turn one in here too. But they've given us the old carbon version, so that will get stuck in the holes like that, and then we just turn that over and solder it. That's our bias adjustment trim pot. So as I said, I'm not going to take much video of this. I'm just only going to do bits and pieces along the way. Now, I still haven't found a IC socket, so yes, you do have to put solder directly to the IC, and I dropped my phone. Gravity. All right. So the next thing I would do is stick the PCB pins in. They've supplied them, so use them. Now, this might be a bit awkward to do properly. I would suggest just start with a couple at a time rather than try and put them all in, then turn the board upside down and then have them all fall out. Because, you know, gravity. Right, I'm going to continue on doing that and come back when I'm finished. And of course the first problem strikes. Where the mic insert is to be put, they want you to put PCB pins in here, but the holes are too small. They're only 0.8, not 1 mm, so those are going to have to be drilled out in order for me to get the pin to go in, because it won't fit in the hole, which is annoying. Now, I think I've experienced this before with short circuits and some J-car kits, that the holes are just not the right size for things. Okay, 1 mm, please. Fortunately, the smallest I've got is 1.5, and it might be a bit big, so I'll just do the one. Actually, I'll do the ground, so it's thicker on the cable. So if I have to pass the cable up through that hole, I will do so rather than using a PCB pin. And all my drill bits just fell on the floor. Gravity. Now I'm going to have to pick them up. Oh no, it'll just work. However, getting it to solder straight is going to be an issue. So what I'm going to do is not worry about the pins, but leave that hole large enough to get the ground connection lead. And I'll just hard solder it to the board and pick up my frickin' drill bits off the floor. So to the people that actually made this board, if you're watching, please update your Gerber file for the 1 mm holes here, so at least you can solder the damn PCB pins you want us to put in. Thank you. Now I would move to capacitors such as the electrolytic and stuff, but that leaves me not able to get the transistors in nice and easy, so I might do them first because I've got a bunch of parts. So I'll do the transistors because they're convenient. That's a PN100, so that one goes in this hole. Got to check them because there's two of one type, and if you put the wrong one in the wrong spot, it will not function. It could also start drawing heavy loads of current, especially if you get the output transistors the wrong way around. Get in there. Let's just solder these in there. Something about the smell of fresh solder in the morning. It's beautiful. I am joking, of course, but I do actually love the smell of solder. That actually bridged, so I just unbridged it. Got to be careful of that, that you don't solder bridge between pins, because it can happen. And it can sometimes be awkward, especially for a novice, to remove without damaging the board. Okay. That solder joint looks like asshole. Anyway, I'll fix it up after I've cut the lead lengths off. And I bridged another one. This is why you don't want to solder multiple components on at once, because if the leads aren't trimmed yet, the length of said lead can get in the way. That looks like arsehole too. Alright, transistors are in, it's starting to look like a circuit. So now I'm going to start with, or continue with, these green cap capacitors, which is what they're called. Now there's only two types here, there's 104 and 224 respectively. The 104s, these ones are 100 nanofarads, and the 224 is a 220 nanofarad. So, and it's marked 220N and 100N respectively, then there's two of each by the looks of things. Except I've only got, oh no, there's three 100s and two 220s. So they're the next step, so I'll start with the 100s. That's why they've given you extra hole positions here, because the lead spacing is empirical, not metric. Did I say empirical? I mean imperial. If you're having trouble soldering around multiple sticking up leads, just go around on one lead of each component and solder one part, and then you can trim that lead that you've just soldered off, giving you more access to other leads that need to be soldered. But that's why you don't put so many components on the board at once. And it's electrolytic capacitor time, including this lonely 10 microfarad capacitor. Now remember to observe the correct polarity. The stripe is the negative, if you didn't know that. And just make sure that it goes around the correct way. It's marked with the positive symbol on the board. So just make sure to observe correct polarity when installing it. You don't want to end up blowing capacitors up, because they tend to make an ear-piercing noise. Now there is two 10 microfarad capacitors. There's one 16 volt and one 50 volt. That's why that capacitor was on its own, because it was a 50 volt version. I would stick the 54 volt nearest to the phone's connections, because, yeah, well, that's going to be where the power output is. It also says on the schematic that the other 10 microfarad should be in LL, or low leakage. Well, judging by these capacitors, they all look like low leakage capacitors anyway, so that's kind of irrelevant right now. And once you've done soldering capacitors in, noting polarity, you should have something that looks like this. Now we're ready to solder the LM3A8 in. And they have indeed supplied me with an LM388. So that's going to go in here. It might be a bit awkward now when it's populated, but because of the way these IC leads are formed, it's not going to fall out when you put it in. So I'm just going to start by soldering one pin on one side. Double checking that it's straight, which it is. And then solder the other corner. And then just work my way down one side at a time. Being careful not to bridge between the pads. Yep, done. I usually like to leave op amps to last because then it saves having surrounding heat getting into the pins for too long and destroying it. The last large component to mount on this board is this 10K logarithmic board, 10K logarithmic pot. Now they do suggest in the instructions that you cut the shaft first before putting said pot on board, but I'm not going to right now because I don't see the need, because I'm not mounting it in anything spectacularly fun at the moment. I might as well just pop a knob on, which is one of those. It doesn't correctly line up with the pot anyway. It's designed for it to be mounted on an angle. I'm not sure what angle. It's designed to be mounted upside down. And even then it's not that great. So, yeah, the knob they supplied is crap, but I'll just stick it on the end there because it came with it. It does come back off. I'm not going to push it on all the way. So that goes in this little location here, like so. And I'll solder one pin, the center pin first, after wiping my iron. So that way I can make sure the pot is straight, which it is now. And then I can solder the remaining two pins and just touch up that center. There we go. The assembly of the circuit board is complete.
Yay!
Alright, I'm about to solder some wires onto this Electret microphone, but I'm not 100% sure which is the positive and which is the negative because it's not marked, which is not handy. But if you notice over here, there's a bunch of what look like solder, well, traces, PCB traces going off to the corner of the assembly here. That was a complete fail. We can see it's actually electrically connected to the outside case. So that is our ground. So what they've done is they've got this earth, for a better term, as well, so that it minimizes the amount of noise being picked up. So yeah, now I can wire some wires on that and wire it to the board. Alright, so I got my audio lead stripped and heat shrunk just to make it neater. You don't have to, you can just leave it stripped as it is. So remembering which polarity was which of this Electret microphone, I can now solder the wires onto it. Now, it is pre-tinned anyway, so you shouldn't have to re-tin it. Oh, that stinks. That was easy. So now I can then mount this to my circuit board. And this is why it would have been nice if the holes were the right size, but they're not. So with my arm getting in the way, and I can't actually see what I'm doing either. So it's a thorough pain in my ass. So are hemorrhoids. Just got to get that wire to go through, which it's just done. So I can now solder them directly to the board. I don't like hard wiring wires to boards because when they break you've got to unsolder them to resolder them, but in the case of this little circuit I don't think it's going to matter too much. And don't keep the heat too long on these, well, the yellow wire in this case, which is the actual signal wire, because it can melt the insulation like it has
slightly melted it. I don't know if you can see that, but it is slightly melted. Anyway, now I can move on to the battery connector. So there's the ground, and that one at the bottom there is the signal. And I can verify that that one's the ground by swapping my connections around. So that's the ground. And we'll notice that that is also a ground. If we unplug the meter now, and I measure across those two pins, they're open. So the way this switch works is as soon as you plug the plug in, these two then get joined together. Now I don't necessarily need to tin the wire before putting it through the hole. It's a lot easier when it's untinned anyway, because once you solder it to the connector, it tins it anyway. Alright, that's one wire. So I've just hooked the untinned wire around the pin so I can quickly solder it to the pin without overheating the pin and pulling it back out of the board. It's not the most easy way to do it, but it's better than having them coming out the top like that. Alright, so all that's left to solder in is the battery clip, and if you want a replacement one of these, the catalogue number is PH9230, just in case you need one or you break one or whatever. So these are going to have to be soldered directly to the pins because they're already pre-tinned. So I'll just lightly tin each pin, observe the correct polarity. Positive goes to the red lead, and the black lead goes to the negative, or else it'll be reverse polarity and it just won't work because of that diode. All right. She is plugged in, well, soldered in. So now, make sure this bias pot's set to the center to start with. We can plug it in and we can take a little quick measurement. Okay, so I've got my battery here, just going to give it a quick measurement. We've got 9.6 volt in a fresh cell. Don't need this audio lead at the moment, so I can get out of the way. Plug this into the thing and see if we get any smoke. So far, no magic smoke. Now, I can verify that this is working, maybe. There's no smoke. If I measure between, well, the 47 ohms at the top here, near closest to where the power connects, and the negative, as we can see, we've got almost half the battery voltage there before the capacitor. So that is telling us that this output state is working in class A. That's why the capacitor is there. So we can see that the circuit is working, and none of these transistors are getting hot. Neither is the op amp, so everything's so far so good. I can plug a pair of headphones in and see if I get any signal coming out. I should do. Alright, I got the headphones plugged in, got that turned in. Oh, I can hear noise, and I can hear myself. Hello, hello. It's a bit distorted though. Hello, hello, hello. You can't hear it, but I can, but it sounds a bit distorted. But they did say that if it sounds distorted, to adjust this, but it is designed to pick up from a fair way away, so there is quite a fair amount of noise there too. Probably not the best op amp. Alright, I will hook this up to my interface and computer once I move some stuff, and we'll do a sound recording directly off of this so you can hear it. But for now it's working. I'm going to play with this bias pot and see if it makes a difference to the sound. Hello, hello. The screwdriver's a bit big. Hello, 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 hello. Hello, hello. Hello? No, the bias pot doesn't make any difference. I could actually put it on an oscilloscope and have a look, but I don't really see the point. For what it is actually picking up my voice quite nicely, and I can hear it from a distance. Even if I have the gain right up, I can actually hear myself. Ooh, that was loud. Hear myself across the room. All right, now it's actually hooked up to my interfacing computer and currently recording. I will stick a limiter on the outputted file just so it doesn't overdrive or anything and keeps it normalized. So the microphone's facing the wrong way, it's facing towards the computer, and it's picking up a bit of noise because, well, it's open circuitry, not shielded, and it's near a computer. Anyway, I'm going to walk over to the corner of the room here, and I'm just observing my peak meters. It's still picking my voice up just nicely. So if I move to the other side of the room, right near the window, I'm talking over by the window facing the other way, and it's probably still picking it up. So, yes, the circuit is working. It's working as good as it's ever going to do. But, yeah, so I think we'll end this recording here. So in conclusion, actually in conclusion, it's a fun little kit to build. It only took me about an hour, but that was only because I was in between filming as well. So about half an hour and you should have something that looks like that. Anyway, this is the Astro 30 saying I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, please remember to go down below and rate, comment and subscribe if you haven't done already. And you can also follow me on Facebook and become a Patreon supporter for as little as $1 a month. I would love some more Patreons, please. Anyway, this is the Astro 30 saying see ya. Happy amplifiers. Well, actually, happy eavesdropping.